The director of music to the tune of The Doe of the Morning, a psalm of David. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me, so far from the words of my groaning? Oh my God, I cry out by day, but you do not answer, by night and am silent. You are enthroned as the Holy One, you are the praise of Israel. In you our fathers put their trust. They trusted and you delivered them. They cried to you and were saved. In you they trusted and were not disappointed. But I am a worm and not a man, scorned by men and despised by people. All who see me mock me. They hurl insults, shaking their heads. He trusts in the Lord. Let the Lord rescue him. Let him deliver him, since he delights in him. Yet you brought me out of the womb. You made me trust in you. Even at my mother's breast. From birth I was cast upon you. From my mother's womb you have been my God. Do not be far from me, and trouble is near, for trouble is near, and there is no one to help. Many bulls surround me, strong bulls of Bashan encircle me. Roaring lions, tearing their prey, open their mouths wide against me. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart has turned to wax. It has melted away within me. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth. You lay me in the dust of death. Dogs have surrounded me. A band of evil men has encircled me. They have pierced my hands and my feet. I can count all my bones. People stare and gloat over me. They divide my garments among them and cast lots for my clothing. But you, O Lord, be not far off. O my strength, come quickly to help me. Deliver my life from the sword, my precious life from the power of the dogs. Rescue me from the mouth of the lions. Save me from the horns of the wild oxen. I will declare your name to my brothers. In the congregation I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you descendants of Jacob, honour him. Revere him, all you descendants of Israel. For he has not despised or disdained the suffering of the afflicted one. He has not hidden his face from him, but has listened to his cry for help. From you comes the theme of my praise in my great assembly. Before those who fear you will I fulfil my vows. The poor will eat and be satisfied. Those who seek the Lord will praise him. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth will remember him and turn to the Lord. And all the families of the nations will bow down before him. For dominion belongs to the Lord and he rules over the nations. All the rich of the earth will feast and worship. All who go down to the dust will kneel before him. Those who cannot keep themselves alive. Prosperity will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord. They will proclaim his righteousness to a people yet unborn, for he has done it.
Thank you, God, that we have your word in our own language and we can read it and understand it. We pray for your Holy Spirit to be near us this morning, whether we are in that darkest place of lament or the strongest place of praise. And help us as your people to be calling everyone to hold those things together. In Jesus' name, amen. Friends, we have made it to 2021. The horrors of 2020 are behind us, and better things are to come. And as we've celebrated a new year on the sofa in our jammies, because that's all we could do, no parties, no drinks out, I've been reflecting on how British people respond in a crisis. We say, mustn't grumble. We laugh at ourselves and we laugh at everybody else. We keep calm and carry on. We apply a stiff upper lip and we persevere. And no matter how bad things get, they are always improved by that classic British solution to just about any problem, a nice cup of tea. We are starting 2021 with a short series on Psalms of Lament. 1/3 of the book of Psalms consists of lament. The psalmist bemoans their own situation, or perhaps cries out to God for what's going on around them, the state of things. And as we continue to go through the most serious crisis in our country since World War II, and probably the world, it will help Christians to connect with our 4,000-year history of lament. As we read Psalm 22, we will see how lament tackles headlong just how bad things really are. And we'll see that that lament is centered on God's character and actions, and in particular the work of Jesus on the cross. There we go. I had flags on the screen, no mention of the B word at all. That's our New Year's resolution in this place. So let's think about how lament, we lament just how bad things are. In Psalm 22, if you've got that with you, have a look down at verse 1. David's starting point is, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me, so far from the words of my groaning? Oh, my God, I cry out to you by day, but you do not answer, by night, and am not silent. David is crying out to God day and night. But God doesn't answer. God is silent. David feels like he's far away, remote from his suffering. This may well be your experience at some stage in your Christian life. For some of you, this might be where you are right now. Many Christian thinkers would say this is a standard part of a Christian walk with God, that there are times when he feels very far away. It is what the medieval theologian John of the Cross called the dark night of the soul. A really helpful book that I often give to people on this very subject is our local guy Pete Gregg's book, God on Mute. Just a really useful reflection on what it means to feel like God is far away. Now, our psalm alternates between David's reflections on suffering and his thoughts about God's character and actions. So in verse 6, he says, he's scorned by men and despised by the people. All who see me mock me. They hurl insults, shaking their heads. He trusts in the Lord. Let the Lord rescue him. Let him deliver him, since he delights in him. And then in verse 12, he describes being surrounded by wild animals, bulls of Bashan, roaring lions. And of course, as a former shepherd, David would have known what it was like to be under attack from wild animals. But what comes next is much harder to relate to David's lived experience. Verse 14, I am poured out like water and all my bones are out of joint. My heart has turned to wax. It has melted away within me. My strength is dried up like a potsherd and my tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth. Verse 17, I can count all my bones. People stare and gloat over me. They divide my garments among them and cast lots for my clothing. You don't really need me to tell you, if you've read your New Testament, that this is a vivid picture of execution. It's very hard to relate this physical picture to anything in David's recorded history in the Bible. Rather, we can see that David is being given a very vivid picture of the suffering of Jesus Christ. That is certainly how the gospel writers saw it, as Psalm 22 is referred to 5 times in the accounts of the crucifixion, more than anything else. And that's why Psalm 22 is often used in liturgies for Good Friday, to reflect on the suffering of Christ. You could argue that the whole psalm is appropriated by Jesus when he quotes verse 1 on the cross, my God, why have you forsaken me? So if you want to reflect on just what it was that Jesus went through on the cross, the physical effects of crucifixion, the spiritual torture of separation from God the Father, this is a very good psalm on which to reflect. Thinking back to those British approaches to suffering, David doesn't say, mustn't grumble, could be worse. If you asked him, how are you, David? He would not say when he writes this psalm, I'm fine, thank you. Rather, David pours out his woes to God. You cannot read Psalm 22 and be in any doubt of what David is experiencing, of what Jesus experienced. And that is where lament starts. That is the point of it. You lay out before God just how bad things really are. You know, David doesn't downplay his suffering. He doesn't say there are other people worse off than he is. It can be a helpful thing to do, to reflect on, well, all those people who are worse off than me, but it is also a way of deflecting what you've lost, what you're going through. So whatever you're going through, you can be real with God. Thinking about those times where God feels remote, Psalm 22 shows us that an authentic Christian response to this is to keep shouting into the darkness, God, where are you? Can't you see how bad this is? You know, over the last 2,000 years, people have sought to downplay Jesus' suffering on the cross. You know, perhaps he wasn't dead when they took him down. If he could speak to those people next to him, was he really suffocating? But Psalm 22 shows you just how bad things really are for Jesus on the cross. You know, the Romans were good at this sort of thing. They were experts in torture and death. Crucifixion was such a terrible form of death that it could not be applied to Roman citizens. It was so bad that the written accounts of the crucifixion in the Gospels are among the only accounts written that have survived of crucifixion. So can I encourage you to lament just how bad things really are? When you're going through tough times, you know, all of us have lost things over this last year. Tell God exactly how you're feeling. If you feel like he's remote, keep going, keep persevering. The starting point of lament is to be completely real. The laments in the Bible encourage us to see our own suffering in the context of other believers through history. And then our other point, remember who God is and what he's done. Because after each bit of lament in Psalm 22 comes a statement of faith. So verse 3, yet you are enthroned as the Holy One. You are the praise of Israel. In you our fathers put their trust. They trusted you and you delivered them. They cried to you and were saved. In you they trusted and were not disappointed. So David remembers what God has done. He delivered the Israelites when they cried out for help. This was the experience of Israel in Egypt, or faced with the people occupying the promised land, or the ridicule of the Philistines. That's the sort of potted history of getting up to where David was. Verse 9, yet you brought me out of the womb. From birth I was cast upon you. From my mother's womb you have been my God. So here is the experience of someone who has felt close to God even from the time before he was born. Friends, if you're one of those Christians, there are many of these in the Church of England who feel like you just don't have a very good conversion story. People, I always ask, when I first meet people in my study or online or however I meet people now, I say to them, how did you become a Christian? And sometimes they're a bit apologetic that, oh, well, I just went to church when I was a child and then decided that that was what I wanted for myself. And, you know, if you were brought up by Christian parents and you think that's a lame story, think again. Your faith, like David's, will be so deeply rooted, it will have its roots in a time before you even have conscious memory that you were with God even when you were in the womb. How extraordinary. David holds on to his faith that God can rescue him. Verse 19, but you, O Lord, be not far off. O my strength, come quickly to help me. He's not saying, oh God, you've left me alone. Well, poo to you. He's saying, come quickly to help me. And his response will be to praise God. Verse 22, I will declare your name to my brothers. In the congregation I will praise you. Verse 24, for he has not despised or disdained the suffering of his afflicted one. He has not hidden his face from him, but has listened to his cry for help. You know, God might feel far away, but he can hear you. He is listening. He is closer than you think. Our psalm encourages us to remember who God is and what he's done. He is always close to his people, even when you can't feel it, especially when you can't feel it. He listens and responds to those who are faithful to him. The psalm reminds us so vividly just how much God loves you, that he sent his only son to suffer and die, and it's right here in those words, so that you might not perish, but have eternal life with him. This is so different, friends, from most people's idea of who God is, isn't it? Even yesterday, I was listening to a podcast from someone talking to the comedian Frankie Boyle, who went to church as a child, a very serious church in Scotland, and was talking about that experience of church. It was so divorced from my experience of who God is. People do not understand, even unfortunately, when they've been at church. Many people think God is all about judgment. His love is conditional on you getting everything right. You know, some religions teach that, don't they? If I tick all the boxes, maybe God will have mercy on me. Or maybe they think God is remote. God is just very, very far away. He set everything going and he's just not involved. But Psalm 22 says no. Psalm 22 gives you a God who is intimately involved with your life, who has known you from the womb. God whose grace is never ending, whose love for you is greater than anybody else's. God who will transform your life if you let his love do that. So then, think back to our flags and our being British about suffering. As we enter 2021, let's just remember who we are at St. Mary of Bethany. Can we remember that vision statement? Oh gosh, nearly 3 years ago we put that in. We are God's transforming people in Woking to love Jesus, to serve and tell others, and to be community. Together, we bless and encourage each other. We are those who will tell God and each other just how bad things are. Of course, in the right setting, we cultivate relationships both one-to-one and in our home groups where we can be vulnerable, where we can say, how are you doing really? Get past that first, I'm fine, thank you, when you're not at all. And we encourage each other to keep focusing on who God is and what he's done for us. The cross of Jesus, which makes us right with God. We always have hope because we are resurrection people. We don't have hope for this year because there's a vaccine coming or because things just have to get better because they're so bad. We have a hope in Jesus Christ and the change that he can bring in the lives of everyone around us. And we believe a day is coming sooner rather than later when we will be together without restrictions, free to shake off our woes with at last that nice cup of tea. Let's pray. And just give the Holy Spirit a moment to speak into your heart about something we've been talking about this morning. Lord Jesus, may your people never be those who don't engage with how bad things really are. Help us to be honest with you, to be honest with our brothers and sisters in safe environments, and pray that our church may provide those places where we can ask people, how are you doing really? Give us those moments this week to check in on those we care for, to look out for those who are vulnerable, to spot those who are suffering. And help us, when we're honest with you, to keep on crying out, to keep on praising you and responding in our hearts with the joy and love that are at your cross. In Jesus' name, amen.